Good morning and welcome to today's webinar. I welcome you all for today's webinar. I'm glad to welcome Dr. Pradeep Mehta sir, who's a Chandigarh Digital Academy faculty member, and he will be making today's session on NDPS Act Law and Procedure. Today would be the part one. These webinar would be divided into two parts. Today is the first part, and tomorrow would be the second part. We all know about how this webinar goes around. So first, Pradeep Mehta sir will take care of the entire detailing, and post which we will open the forum for question and answer round. I would request all the members who have joined in today from various districts of Punjab and Haryana to please post questions in the later half, because a lot of times your question that you have you might have on your mind will already be taken care by the speaker. So just wait for that, and if you don't get your answer, if you still have some query, then you can put it in the question and answer section that we have on the page. I think without a further ado, I, Chetan Singh Gill, welcome Mr. Pradeep Mehta sir, and request him to please start the session. So
thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I welcome you to this session, first session of NDPS Act Law and Procedure. I will make one request that says tomorrow we will be taking care of section 50 and section 52A. And please make it a point that any question which is pertaining to these two sections or a relevant question to that, we can postpone it till tomorrow, and I will be answering those, because you may get the answer of your question in the discussion which I will make. Other questions which you can raise thereafter. So I will start that this act was introduced in 85 by consolidating Opium Act and the Dangerous Drugs Act and other things which were there with regard to the intoxicants, saving the state legislatures to the extent where the law is there in the NDPS Act, or where the NDPS Act in that special legislation of the state. So this is a saving clause which is there in the Act, and it's very important, because there are certain cases which are filed under, you know, Excise Act, despite the fact that NDPS Act is there, and because of the section that which is saving clause, we are having this scenario. And that section is 81, which says saving of state and special laws. Now, to start with, there are a few important definitions in the Act. I will try to deal with only few of them, which are important. That one is psychotropic substance, because the Act is narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances. We must understand that what is a psychotropic substance. So the psychotropic substance means any substance, natural or synthetic. So it can be natural or also produced by synthetic means in the laboratory, or any natural material or salt. Now, why this natural material is that if something is there which is from plant, so there is also a natural material with the plant in which that substance may not be present. And similarly, any salt or preparation of which substance material is included in the list of psychotropic substances. Those are the psychotropic substances. And whereas the narcotic drug is coca leaf, cannabis, opium, and poppy straw, and includes all manufactured goods. So narcotic drugs, as per the Act, are only four things: coca leaf, cannabis, opium, and poppy straw, but also include all manufactured goods. And the controlled substances, which were subsequently added to it, they are the substances which are required to manufacture the narcotic drugs or psychotropic substances, or which, as per the international convention, have been classified as controlled substances. So after this, the manufacturer definition of narcotic drug, it said that includes all manufactured goods. Now, what are the manufactured drugs? Now, here again, first part A, only the narcotic drug. All coca derivatives, medicinal cannabis, opium and derivatives, and poppy straw. So all these were manufactured drugs. But simultaneously, by subsection B, it is said that any substance which is not or preparation, which is central government may, having regard to the international conventions, notify the same in the official gazette as manufactured drug. But simultaneously, a negative clause has been added, does not include any narcotic substance or preparation, clear that it will not be a narcotic drug. So this is the definition which is the definitions. I would like to add that when the act was introduced in 85, there was one tar punishment for all the cases, mostly for possessing some narcotic drug or psychotropic substance. And that was 10 years, may go up to 20 years. So later on, it was felt that when a person is found in possession of, say, 5 grams of opium, the same punishment, and when a person is found in possession of a truckload, again the same punishment. So at this stage, in 2001, they introduced three-tier structure of the punishments. That is, one for small quantity, the other for commercial quantity, and the third one for the intermediate quantity or the non-commercial quantity, which can be so called also. Actually, this three-tier punishment was necessary because of the fact that small quantity was not to be punished with the same as of commercial quantity, or say truck load or 100 kilograms of opium, in contrast to just 1 kilogram of opium. So after this concept of three-tier punishment was added, it was natural that small quantity and commercial quantity were to be defined. So they defined in 2001 the small quantity and commercial quantity. Small quantity in relation to these drugs mentioned as any quantity lesser than the quantity specified by the central government by notification. Remember that any quantity which the central government by notification specifies, the lesser quantity, then that will be small quantity. Scientifically, that was any quantity greater than the quantity specified by the central government. Then, simultaneously, as the central government was empowered to specify the small at the commercial quantity in the official gazette, by the central government made a notification on 19th of October 2001 specifying the small and commercial quantities respectively in column number 5 and 6 of the notification, which was added to the act as Schedule 1. Cases start coming that though the column 5 and 6 represent the quantities small and commercial quantity, but actually definition is less than this quantity so specified. or the greater than the quantity so specified by the central government. And it was being argued in several cases that the quantity which is there in column number 5 as small quantity should not be treated as small quantity, but any quantity lesser than the quantity should be taken as small quantity. And whereas in column 6, which is a quantity greater than the quantity, any quantity which is greater than that should be taken as commercial quantity, and that quantity which is specified in column 6 should be non-commercial or the intermediate quantity. Whereas if we read the notification, then it is written the central government hereby specifies the quantity mentioned in column 5 and 6 as small quantity and commercial quantity respectively for the purposes of said clauses of that section. Now, which refers that this is should be taken as small quantity or commercial quantity. I will take it in other way also. Now, read this definition of small quantity and commercial quantity. In relation to a narcotic drug and psychotropic substance means any quantity specified by the central government by notification in the official gazette. We have deleted the words lesser than the quantity. And here, then we read commercial quantity. It is specified in the government by notification. We have deleted the words greater than the quantity. Now see, this is only for academic purpose. Not a definition incorporated, or it is not a definition. Now, if this is the definition, then it is okay. Then the column 5 will be representing the small quantity and 6 will be representing the commercial quantity. But what about the if then that quantity, and if it is greater than that quantity, and what will do that? Whether that will be small or commercial, then the arguments will be that if we take that definition, it is only this much, because when the 2-3 type punishment was added earlier, it was not there. Earlier, yes, small quantity was defined only under section 2. So this was the natural corollary which was required to be lesser than. Will be discussed. Which are mentioned in column 5 and 6 are the small quantity and commercial quantity respectively, and of course any quantity which are lesser than that quantity also, and the quantities which are greater than that now. Simultaneously, when this was going on, a case E. Michael Raj versus intelligence officer NCB came up. In that case, what was the argument which was placed before the Supreme Court was that of heroin was recovered, and when the test was there, the chemical examiner report revealed that out of the two packets, each of 2 kgs, one was having only 1.6% of it. And the arguments which were placed before the court, however, that the heroin, if we multiply this 1.4% and 1.6% to 4 kgs respectively by 2, it will come only 60 grams. The net content of the pure heroin will be 60% in 2 packets out of the 4 kg. The counsel said that why he should be punished for 4 kilos when he is having only 60 grams of heroin. Pure drug content, because he said that it is only the 60 grams for which he can be punished, and so was the decision which was returned by Supreme Court in 2008, that yes, he can be punished only for a non-commercial quantity and not for commercial quantity. See how much is the difference of sentence. There it is up to 20 years, but here it is only up to 10 years. So then the government in 18th November 2009 introduced note 4 to the schedule, that is one, specifying that the quantities shown in column 5 and 6 with regard to the drugs and psychotropic substances will be considered even if some natural substance has been isotopes, polymer, anything has been added, that esters, ethers, all are if added or whatever is added to it as an will be the pure, not pure drug content, but the total object was that if a person can earn a profit over the content by adding natural substance to it, why then he should be allowed to not suffer the punishment for that quantity. Though under section under class 239, any mixture or preparation which was there of the natural quantity drug content that was added. Now, since it was added, this was challenged that it is not a correct. Virus was challenged in Abdul Mateen versus Union of India before the Delhi High Court, and this said that no, it is not the ultra virus of the act. For the Punjab and Haryana High Court in Inderjit Singh versus State of Punjab, though it was a bail matter, but it was decided that under para 33, 34, and 40. Very relevant that showing the columns for small and commercial quantities, and even this notification which is there is to be obliged, and we have to take the not the net drug content but the total mass which is there as content of the or the weight of the drug for the small or commercial quantity. Then Harpal Singh was there, Harjeet Singh is there, which you can read. But then came the state of Haryana versus Asha Devi in 2005 of Supreme Court, where it was said that 20 kilograms of ganja is a commercial quantity and also more of it is a commercial quantity, which fortifies the contention which was raised by the bench in Inderjit Singh case and the Abdul Mateen's case, and they held that this is the quantity which is 20 kilograms in the column 6 as commercial quantity. However, simultaneously few cases were there in which the decision was returned that it is not good law. E. Michael Raj is good, holding good, but the not the total substance should be taken into consideration, but only the net drug content should be taken into consideration while deciding the case. Then came the decision in Hira Singh versus Union of India in 2020, in which the E. Michael Raj was held to be not good law, and seized mixture and the natural substance of these substances are not to be excluded. They used a word, street quantity. That is selling it in the market, not that what it is natural or the pure drug content. And the amendment in the schedule by addition of note 4 was not ultra virus of the act, as important with regard to the small and the definition of narcotic drug manufacturing substances. The relevant to section 21 provides punishment for contravention in relation to the manufacturer. Only the drugs which are there defined in the section which we have referred out to the.
Hello. Sir, I think you have taken off your PPT.
Yes.
Yeah. So if The PPT is done?
No, it is not done.
So because right now my video is being visible to everyone. So if you can just bring back your PPT, but I think we just stopped seeing your PPT, sir.
Because it is not visible, I will have.
You have to just minimize my window on the top. There's a minimize button, minus button next to the cross button. Just click on that and your PPT will be visible. Do you want me to call Aman, sir? Okay. I'm just calling Aman, sir.
Yes, please call.
Sure. Someone would be here, would be there in 1 minute. I apologize to the audience for this small, I think, technical glitch. I think we'll be back up and running in 2 minutes. Please bear with us.
Oh, it has come.
So it has come, but your screen is not being shared. So your screen sharing has been stopped. So I have just asked Aman would be there.
Sharing of screen has stopped. It's okay.
Aman nu kya minimize kar de meri window bas. Sir, please, sir, you are up. So now we can
start. We can start?
Yes, sir.
So, sorry for the inconvenience. Now we will continue with. Now, Section 21 says a punishment for contravention in relation to manufactured drugs and preparations. Now, these manufactured drugs doesn't mean that anything which has been manufactured in the laboratory, but it is with regard to the definition which is provided in the Act as to what constitutes manufactured drug. That is those four things and the subsequently which are so notified by the central government. And today there are about 106 manufactured drugs which can be charged under Section 21. But so as Section 22 is concerned, it is with regard to the punishment for relation of psychotropic substances. So these are the psychotropic substances otherwise as defined in the definition as which we have discussed. So a very important part, that is presumptions under the Act. See, most important is under Section 35, which is a presumption of culpable mental state. Fact that what is being possessed, every offense which is there with regard to the offenses, those are mostly with regard to the possession. For an offense under this Act which requires a culpable mental state of the accused, the court shall presume the existence of such mental state. So presumption is to be there from the court that yes, mental state exists, but it shall be a defense for the accused to prove the fact that he had no such mental state with respect. Now see here, very important is the culpable mental state, because whenever an offense is there, there should be a mens rea and also that there should be possession or the actus reus. Doing constitutes part of crime as opposed to the action of accused. Fundamental of the principle of criminal lies. Crime consists of mens rea as well as actus reus. Now, what is possession? It is very important because the possession is first the one part of offense. Now, possession can be actual physical possession, then constructive possession, then sole possession, and the joint possession. All are the different types of possessions. And the most important is to constitute an offense a conscious possession. Now, consciousness is the knowledge of the mind which is there with the accused only. Particular fact which is in his knowledge, that is consciousness. That yes, this is the thing which is with me. Now, the possession, this word is very, very important to understand. Because the possession can be joint also. In these cases, a joint possession is also relevant, for which the persons, not person, persons can be charged and convicted. Now we are coming back to the section 35, which says court shall presume the existence of such mental state. Now what is to be proved by now the prosecution before the court? Only the physical part, that yes, possession was there. Now, if the possession is proved beyond reasonable doubt, court is bound to draw this presumption because the word used is shall. Then what will be the case? Say a handbag is given to some person, that this is of my relative, deliver it, since you are going to this place, please deliver it to him, or he will take that this parcel from you. But that parcel in fact is containing some contraband. Now he does not know that what he is possessing, but he will be liable because the prosecution will be able to prove that yes, this article has been found from his possession. Now in case the explanation which has been appended and is very important, knowledge of effect and belief in or reasons to including even the knowledge, and that then the accused, it has proved only when the court believes it to exist beyond a reasonable doubt and not merely when its existence is established preponderance of what is the accused is to prove beyond doubt that yes, this is the thing which was this fact yet from preponderance of probability, but when the court believes it to exist. Now see, the difference is it not proved beyond a reasonable doubt, but when the court believes it to exist, yes, it is the impression of the court which is to be drawn from the facts which are proved by the accused. Now, belief is defined in section 26, and now please you can note down this authority of superintendent legal remembrance legal affairs versus Anil Kumar Bhunja, in which they have said that possession is a polymorphous term which may have different meaning in different contexts. It is impossible to work out a completely logical and precise definition of possession uniformly applicable to all situations in the context of all statutes. Then the discharge of reverse burden. How this diverse burden which has been placed on accused, and it has been said that it will be when the court believes it. This may vary. Now how this can be discharged? This can be discharged by different modes. One is that he can rely on the materials available in the prosecution evidence. Next, in addition that he can elicit answers from prosecution witnesses during cross-examination, or he may adduce new evidence by entering into his defense. Now this has been laid down in Abdul Rashid Ibrahim Mansuri versus State of Gujarat 2002 SCC 565. Now coming to this, when at the point say now accused is adducing his evidence or he is cross-examining the witness, and during the cross-examination court finds that yes, here he has discharged his burden, it was not knowing to him as to what he was possessing, but though he was possessing because he was given this packet which was drawn against you, is over. So it may be at the second stage, it may be at the third stage. So all these three stages are not bound to be observed by the accused. It is at any stage which the court feels that yes, he has discharged his burden. Now the constitutionality of reason in Noor Aga versus State of Punjab, 2008-16 SEC 417, wherein the Supreme Court has said that yes, this is not ultra vires of the constitution because only because of the reason that it is a Darwinian, but since it has been added in view of the international conventions which are there with regard to narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances, it is constitutional. Now there are cases which you can note down or refer whenever it is there. Sky versus State of Punjab is very important. It is a case of pillion rider. The contraband was with the pillion rider, but when the police was seen by the person who was driving the motorcycle, he tried to make a reverse. At that very spot, they were apprehended, and Supreme Court has said that they are committed by Jagdish Rai will also make him liable because he knew it that his pillion rider had the opium or the contraband, and they were having the joint possession of that. Similarly, in Dal Singh's case, it is a car case in which two persons were occupying the car which was coming from Mandi, and when it was apprehended, there was charas which was there in the car for which they were held liable. Now see, there are two occupants, but if there are three occupants, as in case of Gyan Chand, they were held to be in joint possession. What is the reason? Because they were traveling in a private vehicle. Had they been traveling in a public transport vehicle, the matter would have been totally different. Now there is another presumption, which is under section 54, presumption for possession of illicit articles, where it has been said in trials under this act, it may be presumed unless and until the contrary is proved that accused has committed an offense under this act in respect of any narcotic drug, opium, and all that, for the possession which or he fails to account for satisfactorily. Here also, it is a may, court may presume, but the very important fact is that again, for the possession of which he fails to account satisfactorily. Here also, the possession part is to be proved by the prosecution beyond reasonable. If the prosecution fails to discharge the burden placed on it by, see, not proving it that the possession was there without any effect, then the court can draw the presumption under section 54 or under section 35 also, but this can be drawn subsequently. That is with regard to the bound to, and this is because the plea taken will be that he was not having conscious possession. So that part will be not looked into by the court because act has taken care of that. Now coming to the very important section, which is section 25. It is sometimes misunderstood, and authorities are also to the other side also, I will admit. Commission of offense. And whoever being the owner or occupier of having the control or use of any house, room, enclosure, space, place, animal or conveyance. Now these are the things. Knowingly permits. Now the word used is knowingly permits it to be used for commission of offense, punishable under this provision of this act, shall be punishable with an imprisonment provided for the person who is the owner of all these things, house, room, enclosure, space, place, and committed by person who commits the offense under this section, under this act, sorry, of and under any section of this act, shall be punishable. He will also be inviting the punishment for himself as the punishment provided for the offense. But now, what has been laid down by some of the authorities, that if he knowingly permits, not otherwise. No, see how it can be proved that knowingly permits. Now here I will say that definitely Section 35 will be applicable, because what Section 35 says, if you read it now, after going through Section 25, in any prosecution for an offence under which the Act requires a culpable mental state of the accused. Now, who will be accused under Section 25? The person who is lending the vehicle, who is lending the house, who is renting out the room, who is renting out the vessel. So all these things are there for that person whose mental state is in question, which requires a culpable mental state of the accused. The court shall presume the existence of such mental state. So now in this section, when we read again this section C, enclosed knowingly permits. Now knowingly, if we see the explanation appended to knowledge, is also there included in culpable mental state. So this will be also presumed that it will be, the accused will be freed, at liberty to say, dispel that he was not knowing, but he can definitely be taken as accused. So this is all with regard to this part. Now very important part which I will be taking up, and it is the backbone of the, I will say it is the backbone of the case, because link evidence, because even if say they and the case is in the court, link is defective, no amount of evidence can save the case, because link is a very important. Now for this we have to say, what is link? If we say that link evidence is connecting the two situations, the other with the second situation, when that chain is formed with the third loop connecting link. Now see, I can be defined as a relationship between the two things or situations, especially where one affects the other, that is a link evidence. The connection so called which is there in between these two is a link evidence. And in recovery cases, an accused is to be convicted on account of possession of a prohibited substance. Now when a person is apprehended with some so he can be convicted only on account of the possession of that substance if that substance has been declared as it to be proved by the prosecution also, that yes, what was recovered from that accused, from that person, I will say more precisely, that this thing was a contraband, the possession of which was declared illegal by this legislation, that is NDPS Act. Then that will be, according to some, the link is only up to the stage that it has been produced. But no, the link is the proving of the fact that what was recovered from the accused was falling under any of the offenses which are there under the NDPS Act. Say it was poppy husk, it was opium, it was heroin, it was hashish, charas, all that. So now evidence to prove the link, what is the evidence which is required? This is very important part, because now the recovery of the article is there at place A, and subsequently when the court is asked to return the finding that this is opium, we have to prove that the recovery which was there was of opium. Of course, the substance is a case property that has to be produced in the court. As per the Sahiram case, we will be discussing that in a short time. But the most important thing is that how this evidence is to be led before the court, that what is accused. Now, how that can be proved? It's very important. It says, as in all other cases, it is documentary evidence and oral as well as. The documentary evidence, which is material for this, is daily diary register, form M-29, road certificate register, and chemical examiner. Then all these documents, right from the point of recovery, because daily diary register is a register in which every entry with regard of the police station is to be made. Form M-29 is to be filled with regard to the recovery, and sample seal sheet, which is an important part, because then storeroom register, which is called 19, register number 19, so called, in which every entry whatsoever comes to the malkhana is to be made, and whenever it be taken in is to be entered time and again. Then road certificate register, by which the road, thus see, it is a sort of dispatch register by which this sample is sent to the chemical laboratory, signatures are obtained on the road certificate yes, and the register also again, which is showing that yes, this article has been delivered to this very person, and then the chemical report of course, which is admissible under the clause 9 of the CRPC as document which is per se admissible of the chemical report. Then oral evidence, which is the oral evidence which is there in the case which is relevant. It is investigating officer which says that yes, this article, A article, was recovered from the accused, out of which the sample was taken, which was sent to the chemical examiner. Now, gazetted officer, if he is called as per the provisions, then he is also a person who is to be examined as oral evidence that yes, he was called and he actually carried out the investigation. Then the station house, because under this act, a double sealing is required of the material. It is the SHO who is to affix a seal on that articles which are produced before him. Then storeroom register, which is with the malkhana, that is, as we have, that is to be of malkhana munshi in charge, because yes, the I am in charge, whatever material was given to me was entered in the register and was subsequently sent to the chemical or examiner, or it was produced in the court, whatever was done by him, he is to depose in court with regard to that. And then officer taking sample to the expert. He may be head constable, he may be ASI, he may be constable, whosoever he may be, his evidence is also recorded in the court that yes, this sample which was given to me with regard to this case, bearing these seal impressions along with seal chit or form M-29, I deposited it in the chemical examiner. And M-29 is very, very relevant form, because every chemical examiner report is given on the back of the M-29 form, and the opening words are that the sample received to this person and seals were intact and the seal sheet on form M-29. So then the test analysis is there and report is there. So then final the report of the forensic laboratory. Now, this is a case which we discussed, the Sahirams. So this is 2019 4. Otherwise proved. What was required to be proved was that this were kept intact, and that when the samples are submitted for forensic examination, the seals were intact. That the report of the forensic expert shows that the potency, nature, and quality of the contraband material, and that based on and constituting the offense were made out. Now this part lines which have been reproduced in this case beautifully is the link. Then now what is the purpose of sample seal sheet? sample seal, a seal which is affixed on the case property and as well as on the samples which are taken out from the case property. Now in this case, what happened? The sample seal chit was not sent along with the sample from the Malkhana or from the Malkhana Munshi, from the side of Malkhana Munshi to the chemical laboratory. They said the link is defective. Because what is the paper with which the chemical examiner will compare the seal? Yes, say it may be BS written in the record BS, but if the sample seal chit has not been prepared, how that impression of BS will be tallied with that sample seal chit which was sent along with on the case property also, that these two are matching? There can be different impressions of BS. So it is very important. There are other cases. I will refer to just after telling you one thing, that it is generally said, and it is several times held by courts, time and again I will say, several times, time and again, that when there is a delay, it is fatal. No. No, sir, please note it, that even the delay of 40 days, 40 days in Hardeep Singh case were held to be not fit. Because now coming to the main thing, if these seals are found intact on the sample, so there is a option that yes, it has not been tampered with. It has not been tampered with. You know, in this case, say Lakhbir's case, whatever Punjab and Haryana held, that when the it may have been tampered with. It may have been tampered with. Supreme Court said that may have been tampered with is a not to be used, because it is based on that seals are broken, not legible. It means it has Mohanlal case, it was again held that if they are telling both are there, it is that link has not been tampered with, it is proper link. So thank you very much. I am grateful for a patient hearing. Now I will request that if there are questions, those can be asked.
There are, so they already have we already have a lot of questions, sir.
Sir, I will be answering.
Sir, first of all, thank you for detailing this entire session. I think detailing the session in less than 1 hour is itself is a task.
That is why I was in hurry.
Sir, we have a couple of questions, and in the meantime, I would request other members to please put in their questions. So the question is, you mentioned, I think you were talking about the same thing in your session. The question is, in case accused runs away from the spot after leaving behind the contraband, should an inventory be prepared by the magistrate at the request of IO, or case property is to be kept in judicial Malkhana till accused is arrested and produced before the court?
Sir, it requires a detailed answering, and I request the members at the very beginning that this part section 52A inventory and the 50 personal search, please reserve these questions for tomorrow. At the opening of the session, because it will be sheer wastage of time then tomorrow if I answer this in detail, and this requires a detailed discussion. So sir, I will say that we should keep this question for tomorrow. If not, the person who has made it don't mind it.
Fair enough, sir. Fair enough. So
any question which is there again to section 50 and 52A,
mm-hmm.
please, that should not be put for today. If so,
I think it makes sense. It does make sense because tomorrow we'll be anyways be talking about this.
Yes.
So it'll be more specific.
Unless we are at the background of the material, I think I cannot explain.
Sir, I think the member would also agree to this part, and sure, tomorrow the member would be able to. So I would request the member to, you can ask the same question tomorrow. Thank you.
So I will answer this question definitely before the.
I'm sure, sir. So moving to the next question. Now it says whether, as per central government notification, five grams of heroin would be a small quantity, and if it is so, then it would be a conflict with definition which provides quantity less than mentioned in schedule. I think you mentioned about this, sir. You were talking about the quantity.
Quantity included in column number 5, as in Asha Devi of Supreme Court in 2015, is clear that the columns which are 5 and 6 are representing the quantities which are small, and it is small also than that column, and greater than the column 6 are also the initial quantity. So the quantity is definitely small quantity.
Sir, we have a question from Gurdaspur. The question is, presumption and non-compliance of mandatory provisions are independent to each other or are having nexus with each other?
Pardon? Again?
So presumption and non-compliance of mandatory provisions are independent to each other or are they having nexus with each other?
No, they are independent of each other. They are independent. Presumption, you know, you cannot say compliance. No, it is independent.
Sir. Perfect, sir. Moving to the next one. Now we talked about the, you know, that they are different. You know, even if you have a large quantity of, these substances, or if you have some small quantity of substances, the punishment was same. So the question is on the same lines: whether 1,000 grams of poppy husk fall in small quantity or 999.9 gram is small quantity under NDPS Act.
The same answer, that in column 5 it is 1,000 grams.
Mm.
So the same will be the small quantity. It is not 999.9.
Okay.
Yes, of course, 1,000 and also 999.9, 999.8, every quantity which is lesser than that will be small quantity, including the quantity which is there in column number 5, that is 1,000 grams. Because I am very, audible in saying that this was the main question which was answered by Asha Devi, then other cases also, even by the case of Inderjeet Singh Laddi in 2013, in which they have said specifically that the columns 5 and 6, they are the columns which are representing the small and commercial quantity as notified. So no question of taking any quantity which is lesser than that to a small quantity.
So moving to the next one, it is about, it says that if a vehicle is sold on affidavit, but RC is on the name of the register owner, then who will be considered owner for the purpose of section 25?
See, affidavit is of no avail if RC is in the name of a person who has sold it allegedly. Sure. Because even under the Motor Vehicle Act, it is the registration certificate, as held by the Supreme Court in MSET cases, that it is the registered owner of the vehicle.
Okay.
When there is an offense, he can create an affidavit. I have
just
then he should make it to the registering authority that he has sold the vehicle, that he has now, he onwards he will be responsible for the anything which happens to the vehicle. So it should be taken as that he has sold it, and entry should be made in the register. That is must. Yes, if with the affidavit he has done this thing, then it will be okay. If he has not done that, if he has not done that, then register is there silent about selling, then he will be considered as the owner and he will be liable.
So basically only affidavit won't work. Affidavit with register would still work, or otherwise RC would anyways work all the time.
RC will work, but then see, I have told that when it will be a defense to prove it that he was not having the knowing fact that he has lended the vehicle with the knowledge, then he can also prove, disprove it that he was not the owner as he has mentioned it to the, but case will be there on him. He will be charged it under section 25.
So we were talking about charas, heroin and other substances. The question is about in what category smack would come in.
See, smack is a derivative. Smack is a derivative. It will be derivatives of opium. It will be in derivatives of
opium. Of cocaine.
Yes, cocaine or opium, it will be derivative.
Okay. So moving to the next one. I think this question has been asked a couple of times, I think by mistake. Okay. Hello. I think the five times the same question has been repeated. So next question, sir. As per the prosecution case, if lifafa of a case property is stated to be thrown away, then lifted by police, how the police is going to prove the mental state of accused with regards to possession of the drugs? And when the accused comes with the plea that the false recovery has been planted upon him?
This is a question which is basing on evidence. What kind of evidence police proves?
Okay.
No, see, a lifafa allegedly containing opium, so for, or a contraband, what I can make out from the question. A lifafa containing contraband has been thrown. Whether that has been thrown in the presence of the persons of the police, has been identified, whether while he was running video, it has been videographed or see mobile, then he has been apprehended. So all these evidence in a chain will go to prove that yes, this envelope was thrown by this person. And so it will be proved, and the accused will definitely can disprove it that no, he was not there. He was at some other place. They are just making a false, foisting the case on him. So this type of question is not legal or based on law. It is based on evidence. Every case will differ on the basis of the evidence, whether the prosecution is able to prove that yes, this was thrown before them, then he will be charged and convicted. If they fail to prove, it will go.
It will just go. Very well, sir. So we were talking about the small quantity offenses. Now the question is that offenses regarding small quantity, are they bailable or non-bailable?
Very, very pertinent and important question. Very important question. Who has put it?
So the name is not, the name has not been shared. It's just anonymous.
Name has not. Okay. Now here, the answer to this is only in section 37. I will try to take out the act, because 37 is the case in which it is written that whether the bail is there or not there. Now, bailable offense, generally what is there? In bailable offense, the bail is to be granted by the police, if I'm not wrong. That is bailable. When we read the heading of the section, it speaks of offenses to be cognizable and non-bailable. In the see, body of the section, nothing is written. Because when we read subsection, punishable under this act shall be cognizable. Why this is so? Because this act has been, this section has been amended again. It is long. Earlier, all the offenses since were having meant more than 10 years, small quantity concept was not. The offenses were considered as by virtue of sentence that they are. Bails taken in cases where there was small punishment, the legislature in by bill of 88 said that this be added, that it does it, they are non-bailable. So in the heading of the section, it was added that offenses to be cognizable. Since there is nothing in the body, it is generally argued that heading is not controlling legislative intent. So I will differ with this. There is authority of 1985, Bhagirath versus Delhi administration, in which the Supreme Court has held that marginal notes are the legislative intent. They are not editorial exercises. They have specifically written that what is the marginal note was intended to and that should be seen. Now, yes, if it is not limiting, I will agree 100%. It is not limiting the wording which is there in this section. If it is written something with regard to the bail, that only the offenses which are there of sentences more than this, then this would not have been available. But as this section is there, that offenses are non-bailable, so I think that they are non-bailable. There is no offense under the act which is bailable. And this is, I can authenticate it by citation of Union of India versus Ram Samuch, which is of 1999, volume 9, Supreme Court cases, page 429. In which it has been said that this was not the intent of the legislation that the offenses should be bailable. Then there is also a case which is of Supreme Court, and that is, I think, State of Kerala versus Rajesh, in which they have again reiterated this thing, that this was not the intent of the legislation that they should, offenses should be bailable. No, apart from it, I would like to refer to authority Ansar Ahmed versus State, 2005-4 RCR criminal of Delhi High Court, in which 3.5 grams of heroin was there and the person was inside the jail. The Delhi High Court granted him bail under 47, saying it that this is a case where the bail should be granted of the on account of the small quantity. No limitation is there. What is being argued that in this section there is a clause B which says that the no person accused of an offense punishable under offenses such and such shall be released on bail on his own bond unless the public prosecutor has been given an opportunity to oppose the application for such a release. And when it is so, then reasonable ground for believing that he has not committed the offense and he will not commit is to be returned in the by the court. Now, this is very material. Okay. This part, this part is not to go bailable. This goes to show that this is in addition to section 439. This is a very long topic. This can be seen. I am just going precise because it is a question which I am answering. But the answer is that, to my mind, ratio of the law, which is there, they are non-billable. All offenses are non-billable.
Okay.
CRPC schedule 2, by virtue of this sentence, because it is a special legislation in which special content has been made in a section. Though there are authorities, several authorities, I
sir, we lost you.
So
could you repeat the last sentence? We couldn't really understand. We lost your voice. So could you repeat the last sentence? We lost your voice. Could you hear me, sir?
Which is requiring detailed discussion. But of course, even the Delhi High Court has subsequently held that the offences which are punishable up to 3 years are bailable by intent of CRPC Schedule 2.
Okay.
But to my mind, to my logic, this is not correct approach. The correct approach is based on the wording which has been held by the Supreme Court recently, that it was not legislative intent to make the offences bailable. That is why they have added this word.
So,
it's a very dicey question.
I can understand that with the explanation that you're giving, because I think even the explanation had so many ifs and buts. So I understand it's a very elaborative answer that is required, and it's a different situation that comes in place in the place.
Various situations. But see, if we read the authorities which I have mentioned, the Delhi High Court 2005 and the Supreme Court 1999 and 2020, January 20, where they have shown that, and the legislative intent of the bill which was introduced in 88, it is bill number 129 of 88. That intent will show that this wording, that offences to be cognizable and non-bailable, is sufficient margin note which says that they are non-bailable, because there is not contradictory anything in the body of the section.
So now, if your permission, with your permission, I would like to go to the next question.
Yes, please.
So the next question is, if accused files default bail application, then whether it is necessary to give an opportunity to public prosecutor to oppose said application in the view of section 37, subpart 1B, subsection 1 of NDPS Act, whether it would make any difference
The question is not clear.
Do you want me to
repeat it? Should be 36, not 37, if I'm not wrong.
Okay. Maybe so. I'm not really aware of NDPS Act that thoroughly.
You can repeat the question.
So the question is, the accused files for a default bail application. Now, whether it is necessary to give an opportunity to the PP to oppose said application in view of section 37 subpart 1B and subsection 1 of NDPS Act, whether it would make any difference in case of small quantity or in case of commercial quantity.
See, now here comes the question itself. And since small quantity.
Could you repeat that? I think we lost your voice, sir.
See, the question which the person who has put the question, sir, is himself suspecting it, that small quantity is also bailable, because he is saying it make any difference when the quantity is bailable and small or commercial. So when a small quantity is there, there is no question of 167. try to understand the person who has made the question. It is only when it is not bailable that he will be inside the court, jail, under the judicial custody. Now only then 1672 will be applicable.
So,
36A. Now see, there is an extended period of under section 36, under section 36A. Here now it is a default bail. Default bail, when extended period of limitation is there, the application is required to be filed before the expiry of the first period. So this is very important. This is not question pertaining directly to the NDPS Act, but also involvement of CRPC under 1672 is there. Before time, if the application for extension of time under section 36A has been made, then the right of the person will not be there, as in case of Nirala Yadav, Union of India versus Nirala Yadav 2014, Supreme Court. It has been held, which is reported in Supreme Court cases, that when the right of the accused has accrued, the police or the prosecution cannot be allowed to defeat it by filing an application for extension of time subsequently. Now, meaning thereby, if the first period of limitation, say of 60 or 90 days expires, or 180 days expire, then the application must come before the expiry of that period, that they want extension in time in view of the subsection 36. If that is not there, the time is not to be extended, then of course the bail will be there, default will be there, on account of they have failed to place the challan in the court in the stipulated period which was there fixed for their investigation, then definitely they will be out of the court and the bail will be granted to the accused. He may be accused of a commercial quantity. If the application for extension of time is there, it has been, then there is no question that the application will be rejected. It will be heard. Notice of the same will be given to the accused that they have, and the right will not accrue on the expiry of that period to the accused unless the extension of time is there or it is refused. Now, if it is refused, definitely on the grounds which is, on which it is refused, the bail will be granted. But if it is allowed, the is it clear? Please
sir,
ask
that. Sir, if it is allowed, then what?
Obstructing, I think.
So you said if it is not allowed. When you said if it is allowed, then?
Hello.
Sir, can you hear me?
Oh.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, but I think the voice is disrupting, I think, if I'm not
wrong. I think so in between. I think I just want to, could I request you to please repeat the sentence when you said it is not allowed, we understood, sir. If it's, when what is happened, when if it's allowed, then what happens?
See, yes. Now, I will start from that case. Application is there of the prosecution for the extension of time, which is there well in time, as laid down in the law in Nirala Yadav's case. Now, when that application is there, notice of the same is given. Challan has not been presented. Of they want the extension on the basis of the fact that investigation is still not complete. Then, if it is allowed, the period will be taken as extended. After hearing the accused, period will be taken as extended to the next period, say even to 1 year, or say 2 months. Or 1 month further, the request is accordingly. But if it is refused, the bail will be there for the default bail. I will say default bail will be there for the accused if that period of extension is refused.
Okay. So, moving to the next question. The question is
who had put this question? I will definitely like.
This question is with one of the most, I think, Mr. Neeraj Goyal, who's been a very very active in these webinars. I hear Mr. Neeraj Goyal's name a lot of time in the question answers section.
He is a magistrate or an addition session?
Sir, he has not really mentioned that, but he's been very, very active. So Mr. Neeraj Goyal, sir, has been very active in these webinars.
Because he will it clear. Understanding the thrust of the wording which I have said.
Okay.
Anyhow, continue.
So there's another question from Mr. Neeraj Goyal, sir. It says that if an application of accused for default bail is pending and the PP files an application for extension of period of investigation beyond 180 days, then in that case, whether the right of accused to default bail is extinguished?
Which is what I said, I want to talk. This is there in my earlier answer. And that if application is filed by the accused, is the same thing which he has asked?
Sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
No. He cannot file, accused cannot file the application before the expiry. See, if it is 60 days, sir, he is on the expiry of 60th day, when the challan has not been presented, application has not been presented for extension of time. Try to understand. Both the things go simultaneously. One is extension of time, and the one is that I may be granted default bail. If the expiry of the period of 60 days or the first period of limitation, it may be 180 days or otherwise, then. Sure. If the application subsequently filed by the police, that time may please be extended, that definitely it will be filed after 180th day or after the first expiry of period of limitation when the right to has accrued to the accused. And when the application is subsequently filed, as I have just said, in Nirala Yadav's case, the Supreme Court has categorically laid down that prosecution cannot be allowed to frustrate the right which has accrued in the favor of the accused. So that becomes final and prosecution will not be allowed the extension of time if it is filed after the first period is over.
So
I think answer is there to this person.
So the question is about sometime police mentioned that weight of the heroin is five gram, including lifafa. Then same would be considered as small quantity.
Yes.
I think.
I am very much perturbed over this. Now, what is the question? Who has put this question? Again, Neeraj Goyal?
No. It's someone else, sir.
See now, Chetanji. I would like to answer that your question is that if there is a lifafa and inside it is heroin,
yes, sir,
which is total weight is 5 gram. This is the thing.
So
if the weight of lifafa may be gram, 2 grams, right?
So.
Isn't it?
Sir, could you repeat that? Lifafa weight is 2 gram?
I think the question is, what I have understood is that the question is that if there is a lifafa and inside it is a heroin.
Yes, sir.
And the total weight of the lifafa is 5 grams.
Yes, sir.
The heroin which is there inside the lifafa will still be a small quantity?
Or not? Yes, sir. That's the question.
This is the question?
Yes, sir.
No, see, in column 5, is in column number 5, which means small quantity. And the definition says any quantity less than the quantity so specified by the central government in the official gazette. Now, in official gazette, quantity of 5 grams as small quantity.
So I think we lost your voice, sir.
Any quantity, I don't know what is happening.
Sir, let's do one thing, sir. You have an option over, or you can switch off the video. So what will happen is it will just make sure that the bandwidth has only been given to your audio, to your voice. Can you see that there's an option in the center, sir? And the first option on your left-hand side, there'll be a small camera would be made. Just click on that next to the mic. Click on that, your video will just go off, sir. So that will at least increase the bandwidth, sir.
Now it is all right?
Yes, sir. So now I can't see you. No one can see you. But sir, please, sir, if you can try speaking now, sir.
I can speak. No problem. Sure. No issue.
Now we can hear you, sir. Now we can hear you, sir.
Now the thing is that the question is that now the total content of the lifafa is 5 gram, and inside it is heroin. Sir. Now the question precisely is whether that heroin will be still a small quantity. This is the question.
Right,
yes.
Sir, this is the question.
This column 5, which has been there in the schedule, says that 5 gram heroin is small quantity. And when we read the definition, which is there in the act, there is any quantity lesser than the quantity so specified by the central government in notification as small. So any quantity which is there less than the 5 grams will be small quantity, even from 0.1 gram of heroin to 5 grams, every quantity will be a small
quantity.
Yes.
So, moving to the next question, sir. The question is, there is an error in inventory order passed by the magistrate who is transferred. Then the successor magistrate can clarify.
252A. I think time and again I have. He comes into picture, everything is to be dealt with first under section 52A. Only then the question.
Sir, if you allow, I may ask the second last question of the session now.
Anyhow, please, most welcome. You can ask any number of questions, sir. But accept only those two sections, because that will be a
fruitful for tomorrow.
And again, to explain that will be sheer waste.
Sir.
Had it not been a two sessions, I would have answered it.
Yes, sir. I understand that, sir. Sir, the question is, normally what happens is that the prosecution does not project the owner of the vehicle as an accused. He is only joined as a witness at the stage of 161 CRPC.
Your voice was cracked, actually.
Okay, sir. Sir, I'll repeat again. He's saying that normally the prosecution does not project the owner of the vehicle as an accused. He is only joined as a witness at the stage of 161 CRPC. It is never the aim of the prosecution to try the owner as accused despite section 25. How the court should proceed when the application for superdari is filed by owner, whether the court should do suo moto, proceed under section 139, sorry, sir, section 319, and summon the owner as co-accused.
See, what type of application is moved by the accused? Witness who has rendered the vehicle. The police in every case should keep him as accused, because it is for the court to decide that whether he is innocent or not. It is a part of investigation. Also, if the investigation, they found that yes, he has actually sold the vehicle, they can collect the evidence, as I have said, that he informed the document by some document, authenticated document to the licensing authority that I have sold this vehicle. But if he has not sold that, he should be kept as accused by the police. But yes, if they don't, they keep him as a witness, which in most of the cases they are doing it intentionally, I will say, because they are circumventing the law. Then, of course, the court is free to, because the if there is an application of 319 from the prosecution, yes, he can summon him as accused. The court can summon him because there is no sanction which is required to be to see plead him as an accused or to frame a charge against him, as in corruption cases. And of course, the sanction is required. The court is handicapped. But if 319 application is made by the prosecution, that no, he should also be tried because he knowingly, as per the withdrawn from section 35, he is to be tried. Then he should be taken on record as an accused. So, he can be taken.
Sir, a question about can a police remand for small quantity? Can there be a police remand for small quantity?
Your voice is cracked.
So, could you hear me now? Can you hear me now, sir? Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear.
So the question is, can there be a police remand for small quantity? Can there be a police remand for small quantity?
Which is contrary to that, whether it is available or not. That whether there can be a request for police remand.
Yes, sir.
It is first that it is not available. Produced before the court. Now see, in this case, see, if we go to section 52, which says disposal of the accused along with the case property, then there is section 67. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Section 67.
There is section 57 in which the report of arrest is to be made. It is to be informed. Then 67 interrogation or investigation during inquiry can be there. He can be asked to. There are several authorities on 67 also. But now the question is that when an offense is. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir. When
an offense is not available, accused is produced before the court, then police is not barred, even in small quantity, to ask for the police remand or the judicial remand. It is their prerogative to ask for the police remand. So you cannot say that police, the question was, can the police ask for police remand? Why not? The police can ask police remand, but there should be tenable grounds. There should be logical behind that why you want the police remand? No, I will tell you one thing. Now 5 grams, time and again, question has been asked on heroin.
Mm-hmm.
5 grams of heroin is a small quantity.
So,
now what is the price of heroin? If I'm not wrong, in international market, it is 6 crores per kg. Isn't it?
So,
6 crore rupees per kg, 60,000 per gram, 30 lakhs rupees of 5 gram. 3 lakhs for 1 gram. Now, a person who is possessing 3 lakhs, from where he is earning? Police demand can be asked if they want to thrash it, isn't it?
Yes.
I can't say even to the police as a prosecutor that comes their job, whether they want a police remand or a judicial remand in an offense which is cognizable and non-bailable. It is depth of the case required or not. Now, if they want, now say, if a person who is found in possession of 4.5 grams or 5 grams of heroin, from where he has got the money?
Yes.
Whether this section was process. If they want to see, go into depth, they can ask for the remand. And the court is free.
So I think basically, sir, the police can ask for remand even for small quantity, because the small quantity is small, but the value of that small quantity is pretty big. And that, I'm sure there can be other
reasons.
Offense
is offense. Yes, if it is non-bailable, definitely.
Sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. If it's non-bailable, and then we lost you, sir.
Then yes.
Yes. Okay.
Hello?
Sir, yes, sir. I understood, sir. We heard you, sir. So the last question for the session is on 23rd of April this year, three judges bench overruled a case of E. Michael Raj.
Yes.
So the question is, what is the position now?
See, Hira Lal's case.
Hira
they referred it. Hira Lal case I referred. This is that case in which they have overruled. Now in that case, the first, they have decided 3 points. The first point I pointed out, E. Michael Raj is not a good law.
Mm-hmm.
Second was that whole drug content, and I use the word street weight of the drug is to be taken into account. Meaning thereby, that whatever is the total bulk quantity, irrespective of the net drug content, is to be taken into for assessing whether it is a commercial quantity, non-commercial quantity, or small quantity. I will give an example. Say 10 grams of heroin is mixed with 1,990 grams of natural material or neutral material. Natural material or neutral material, say white powder.
Okay, sir.
Just paracetamol crushed and mixed with it. Just compost crushed and mixed with it. Just white powder mixed with it. Sail khadi, I will use the word sail khadi, to make it 1 kg, it sure will be taken as commercial as per the new law.
Okay.
It will not be taken as only 10 grams of heroin has been
there. No. Yeah.
No.
So where should I start again? No, you just said that the as per the new law, that will be considered 1 kg, and then we lost you, sir.
It will be considered as 1 kg.
1 kg.
Grams of heroin, which has been found as per the chemical.
Sir.
Not been held good law. To be. Not ultra virus of the act, that class 4 was added to the schedule of next 1, which was there for that any material which is neutral material, not natural material, which was included in 239. And the street bulk will be taken in. So 3 points have been held in that last case.
In the new act.
I think. Person who has have not heard when I was specifically saying he was either not available at the before the net or he was, had gone somewhere else when I answered that.
So,
next question.
So I think we are done with all the questions.
Thank you.
And I think I think the one thing that I must admit during the session, though there were a few challenges in the audio, that's a secondary part. They are beyond, I think, our control. Sometimes technology acts weird. But I think you have shared so many authorities that I think if I can recall, I think almost the second or third sentence had an authority in your webinar. So I'm sure the members who had joined in today, who had heard you on this webinar, they are surely going back with a lot of information, a lot of clarity on the subject, but also with a lot of authorities that they will actually help them. Because I think that is a very important part, because I've been training a lot of judicial officers from so many years, and I have learned one thing that, finding authority is one of the most challenging work. And like you have given so many authorities on a particular point, on a particular act, I'm sure that is surely going to be a help to all the members who had attended the session.
Mr. Chetan, I will add one thing here. Though you are saying that I have fortified my saying with authorities, you have a third or second sentence was authority. But actually, it is logic, lies logic. How you put it, how you put the authority into the point where you are saying something.
So,
this is important. Authorities are both ways. You can call out the portion which is there. As you have said, give the maximum number of authorities so the officers can read and reach at a conclusion. And then me any time, because they are judicial officers and the respected judicial session judges, Punjab, Haryana and UT Chandigarh, they can contact me at any time. If even now there is any point on which they are feeling doubt, so they are free.
So
there can be question.
I'm sure. So I think for today's session, I think we have still got a lot of questions, and like you said, if members have any more questions, they can obviously reach out to the academy and then further reach out to you. So I think, sir,
tomorrow is there, Arthur. Tomorrow is there.
I was about to say that. So I think, sir, if you allow, I will just give a vote of thanks and conclude this session.
Please, I am thankful to all the officers who have heard me patiently and have which have added to my knowledge or to I had answer and will be increasing my knowledge further. Thank you very much.
So on behalf of Chandigarh Judicial Academy and on behalf of Dr. Pradeep Mehta, sir, I would like to thank all the members who have joined in, all judicial officers who joined in from Punjab, Haryana, various district courts, and took out time on a working day to sit down on this webinar. We are really thankful, and we hope that the session was fruitful and the session.
I hope so.
And we'll be coming back tomorrow with the second part of this NDPS Act, Law and Procedure. The questions which were dealt today were specific to a certain part of it, and the next part would, like sir said in the starting, would be dealt tomorrow. And there was a question earlier that members wants the PPT of sir. Was sir was saying, sir, is it possible we can share the PPT, sir?
No, sir.
I'm sorry, sir.
It is not proper to share it.
Okay.
I think, however you are, I think I will see to it.
Okay, so I think I will suggest members to contact the Judicial Academy for that, and then that can be talked out separately.
Yes.
But anyways, I think the reason why would you not need a PPT is because all the sessions are being recorded, and these all sessions are also being put on YouTube.
That is also there. Yes. So it is already with the YouTube, and anybody can see to it, right, who has been, because they are enrolled, and they are being sent the link, and they can see to it, and no question of sharing it.
Right, sir.
So it is also there. And one thing more I will say to you, Chetan, please don't mind. I am not doctor. I'm not doctorate, not PhD. I am only, I worked as a director, joint director of prosecution in my career, and thereafter, after my retirement, I had joined it.
So
33 years of service.
So I stand corrected.
Please don't address me as doctor.
So I stand corrected. Thank you. My apologies.
No, it is not. You have.
Okay, sir. It is. I think it is a correction. So I will take that. And I think on behalf of Mehta sir, on behalf of Chandigarh Judicial Academy, on behalf of SSC Online, I Chetan Singh Gill, thank you everyone, and we'll see you tomorrow on the session. Bye.
Thanks.